Good evening. I'm going to try and give you a general summary of the events of the last 2 days, mainly for camp information. I think most of us in Stanley are fairly well briefed. We heard reports from the camp that an Argentine airliner had been seen flying overhead.
Next thing, there was this tremendous roar, and all we could see was the belly and the wheels of the aircraft.
And this huge aeroplane was flying towards us, very low over town. It almost looked as if it was going to touch the telephone wires.
Anyway, by the time we got up to the race course, sure enough, there was an Aerolíneas Argentinas DC-4 plane bedded down on the race course, and there was a load of types coming out of her.
It became increasingly obvious that there was a bit of an emergency, and in fact during that period a state of emergency was declared.
When we saw the people with guns, we thought this is pretty strange.
Did you do your national service? Yeah. Here's a machine gun, you know, have you done? And there's a rifle.
I worked at the power station out for the Falkland government as an electrician when at the time of 1966, I'd been there quite a few years. Did my apprenticeship and then was senior electrician.
I was 16 at the time, and I was an apprentice radio operator with the British Antarctic Survey.
I was teaching second year infants in the infant and junior school here in Stanley.
I applied to volunteer with voluntary service overseas, and to my amazement, I was selected. And then even more amazed to discover that along with about 200 other people, I was selected to go to a less developed country, but in this case, the Falkland Islands rather than Fiji or Jamaica.
At that time, we had a monthly shipping link with Montevideo and Uruguay. We had no air links in 1972, and we didn't have too much communication around the island. We had an air service, but no roads going out of Stanley. It's all four-wheel drive transport. We wanted to go out to any of the farms. And it was pretty quiet, very secure, and that life was generally pretty good, I think. People were pretty happy with themselves.
I think the most important thing about settling down there when you're 18 was the fact that you were quite a long way from home, and there was no telephone communications for a whole year, and getting used to a monthly mail delivery.
It was all very peaceful, and life went on much the same as it had for a long, long time before that.
The winter of 1966 was actually quite a snowy one, and we had snow on the ground really up until at least second week of September. It was quite fortunate in a way that had all passed by the time the aircraft arrived.
On the 28th of September 1966, I went into the school to do teaching practice. And at some point during the morning, we heard the noise of a low-flying large plane. As someone who was pretty used to that in my daily life, I wasn't quite as disturbed as the children and the teachers.
A friend of mine, another electrician, were working up close to the golf course, and we heard an aircraft, looked up, and this Aerolíneas Argentinas aircraft flying past quite low, the DC-4.
And the painters were in doing some work in the school, and my uncle, who was one of the painters, came into the classroom and said to me, "Come and have a look at this." And he took me to the hall, and we looked out in an easterly direction, and this huge aeroplane was flying towards us, very low over town. It almost looked as if it was going to touch the telephone wires.
And then it flew down right over the harbour, come down back low over Stanley. Obviously, when he flew past the first time, he was looking to where he could land.
Next thing, there was this tremendous roar, and all we could see was the belly and the wheels of the aircraft going over the gorse bush as it came in to land at the racecourse.
There was a piece of peat dust off the old peat sod, peat mould on the racecourse, which he the lorry loads, truck loads, he completely spread them very quickly. It's quite dramatic, the landing, but landed quite safely and came to halt.
We didn't know in the school what had happened for a while, because obviously we were there with the children. But then word got through that a plane had landed on the racecourse and got bogged.
We were due to go to Government House for lunch with the governor's wife. And so we smartened up and got in the cars and had a lift to go for lunch. And we actually passed this plane on the way and knew something was amiss.
And we went down towards the aircraft and people were jumping out and we saw people had guns, so we didn't go too close. They surrounded the aircraft and started handing out leaflets to people. I refused to take one, but it was just a protest about the British having the islands, I think, but I never ever saw one.
When they leapt out on arrival, they put up a rope and post perimeter on which they hung Argentine flags, and they handed out declarations to some people. Declarations are the usual. It's very badly printed, and in fact I haven't a copy, but I have some notes that the place was going to be renamed, and of course all locally born persons would become Argentine citizens and enjoy the pleasures of that state.
The hijackers were armed. They were from a group called El Condor Peronis, right-wing Peronis, and there were 19 of them. And the plane they'd hijacked was a 60-seater from Aerolíneas Argentinas, internal flight, 60 seats. And therefore there were actually 25, 26 passengers, some of whom were children, who were part of this unfolding incident.
But then the Argentines started taking the guerrillas, militants, the hijackers. They took about seven or ten hostages.
Two of the first people on the scene, including Sergeant Peck, went up to them quite naturally and were promptly herded into the plane at gunpoint. Very shortly, it was decided that these chaps had come here on a demonstration and they had to be cordoned off by our own security troops.
When I went home at lunchtime, they just broadcast on the radio that all members of the Falklands Defence Force and any other able-bodied people should report to the drill hall by 1 o'clock.
During the afternoon, my colleagues, the two guys that I went with, who both went to schools where there were army cadet forces, volunteered us, although I must admit, in my case, I volunteered without my my prior sort of discussion, because I had never handled a gun, let alone a semi-automatic rifle, in my life.
At that stage, I'd just joined the FIDF and had completed my basic training. So I had a uniform and everything, and duly reported for duty.
I never had to fire the gun, but I do have memories of lying in wet grass for quite some time with the expectation every so often, as we were asked to, ordered to be on alert, that it might happen.
The Defence Force had turned out in force. We never knew how strong we were. 150 present and past members were there. The entire area around the plane is cordoned off by members of the Defence Force, the Marines and the police.
Actually, I was involved putting floodlights up in the nearby houses. And somebody had the bright idea of putting loudspeakers up on the roof of a house and playing loud music all night, which they did. And anyway, the following day in the afternoon, late afternoon, the hijackers thought, this is enough, it's enough, and they surrendered.
I think they were getting tired, dirty, fed up, and the toilets on the plane were backing up, and food was running out.
The hijack was resolved by a process of negotiation led by the Catholic priest, who worked with the purser of the flight, who was an English-speaking member of the crew. And gradually, the hijackers let hostages go.
But we saw Father Rowell, the Roman Catholic priest. We actually saw him going up to the aircraft and negotiating with them, because actually the hijackers surrendered to the Roman Catholic Church. they didn't surrender to the government or the military. Once they had actually surrendered and gone into St. Mary's Annex and the hall, we then spent the next 2-3 days actually guarding them there.
And then the next news we heard that an Argentine military freighter was coming, was on its way down the coast, and somewhere between Argentine ports, and that diverted here. And that was the following day. And then they came in, and finally everybody was transferred onto the ship, except the crew. The four crew members stayed, and they prepared to get sorted out to get the aircraft away again.
The whole incident really lasted for about 5 days, from beginning to end, when the hijackers and the passengers were dispatched on this Argentinian warship. And then subsequently, 2 or 3 days later, they were able to get the plane off the race course, having taken all the seats and the galley and absolutely everything out of it.
And I actually sat on the ridge and watched it take off. And my first roll of film was actually clicked away at the aircraft going down the race course.
He told the local photographer that he'd be airborne in about 400 yards from the start point. So the photographer went up just past the 400-yard point, and he was just about right on, 400 yards, the aircraft lifted. Pretty short run for an aircraft the size of DC-4.
It really was an amazing feat for a large aircraft. The length of the race course and the condition of the ground as well, he really had to be a superb pilot to have pulled that off.
And it flew off. And he circled the town and came back up over the race course, very low, probably 100, 150 feet. The opportunity for lots of people to take good photographs of it. And then disappeared into the west and on his way back to Argentina. Drama over, if you like.
This is the biggest sight. And they're moving. They're off the brakes. They're away down the course. She's absolutely going straight level. The dust is flying, she's at the 200 mark, she keeps on, she's absolutely dead straight, the dust is flying in the peep mould, 300, 400, she's getting on down, she's off, Jim Carr says she's up, she's off the ground, she's away, a perfect takeoff at 400 yards, never a wrong movement. Now we'll just see whether she's going to turn round and come and say goodbye. And she's rising way up in the air. Those 150-foot masts look nothing already. She's nowhere near the 800 mark now. Just now he is circling round over Stanley Harbour. She's over the Beaver Hangar now, and she certainly is going to come back and say her final farewell. Now the race course is getting thronged with people, and you can see how many people have been around here. Well, that's very nearly the end of the flight of this airliner, which is still circling around the harbour. There she's now over the ridge on the other side, still proceeding eastward. She must be up at about 1,000 feet now, sun shining, and everyone in Stanley will be so glad to think that this event, which has been planned for the last 10 days, has now come off successfully, and these lads are safely on their way home.